as I said, this is the last topic we are going to cover in single degree of freedom systems. And it's a very important topic. We learned that in general, if you have a forcing function, f of t, acting on our single degree of freedom system, the general response for the case of an undamped, but of course slightly damped or underdamped system would look like this, 1 over m omega t. I would write that in the general form, integral from 0 to t of e to the minus zeta omega n times t minus tau sine of omega d t minus tau d tau. So this is a general form of the steady state response of a damped system under the action of general forcing function. And obviously if damping is zero, in the case of undamped, this will be reduced to this form. This becomes 1, and omega d becomes omega n. So we take this simpler form. So we derived it, we did the one example last time, which was the case of an impact load, which is a constant load that is applied at some instant of time. And the difference between that and the static load is that, of course, we assume no energy loss, you drop a weight on some system, and then it's as a result of that, which is basically initiating some initial conditions, start to vibrate. We derived that and we concluded that for the case of undamped load, the dynamic load factor, or DLF, okay, which is the maximum value of the dynamic response over the equivalent static response, was 2. So we demonstrated that for the case of zero damping. Let's look at the case that now we do have damping, but this damping is, of course, very, very small. So basically, that's what we have, and the forcing function is the same. So what we need to do is solve that equation, and in solving this, or finding this integral, what we consider, tau is a dummy variable. That's how, mathematically, basically, you look at this integral and perform the integration. So let's do that. So in this case, I'm not going to go through the details of that because I'm going to do other examples. Yes?
Should there be the forcing function in
the... Oh, here it is. Sorry. How did that happen? Thanks for the observation. And here too, damping does not remove the force. Thank you. So let's look at that. We want to derive basically solution to this integral. For the time being, because I'm going to do a lot of other examples, I will just give you the result of this integration. If you do that, if you perform the integration, what you end up with would be something like this, f0 over k times 1 minus e to the minus zeta omega n t times cosine omega d t plus zeta over 1 minus zeta squared, square root of that, sine omega d t. That's what you end up with. So you want to find the maximum value of basically this, because that's what you need. You want to find the maximum value of displacement, it's a constant term, or the static displacement multiplied by that, and that's what you want. If you want to do that, you just need to integrate that with respect to time and equate it to zero. This will give you a time at which this minimum, maximum value occurs. Substitute that into this equation to find the U max. That's what we do. So let's just take the derivative. If you take the derivative, this is what you end up: du of dt would be zeta omega n e to the minus zeta omega n t times cosine of omega d t plus zeta over 1 minus zeta squared sine omega d t, okay, minus e to the minus zeta omega n t times minus omega d sine omega d t plus zeta omega d divided by 1 minus zeta squared cosine omega d t, which you need to equate that to zero. You see that there are terms here that would actually cancel out. Okay, for instance, you have, if you simplify this, what it results, it would result into zeta omega n cosine omega d t plus zeta squared over 1 minus zeta squared sine omega d t plus omega d sine omega d t minus zeta omega n cosine omega d t equal to zero. This one and this one cancel out. You factor out sine omega d or sine omega d t. You get something like this. You just get zeta squared omega n over 1 minus zeta squared plus omega d times sine omega d t equal to 0. So that's du over, du dt that you need to equate to 0 to find the time which corresponds to the maximum value, and substitute that into this equation. So from here you can easily see that this is a constant. In order for that to be zero, this has to be zero. For this to be zero, that means omega dt would be pi, or a factor of pi. So that's what makes du dt equal to zero. Or in other words, the time at which that would be zero would be pi over omega d. So this is the time corresponding to du dt being zero or ut being maximum. So you just need to substitute this. So substitute this into this equation. Okay. So if you substitute that into that equation, what you will get would be basically for this part, which we call a dynamic load factor, okay, which is the term in the bracket, you get dynamic load factor would be 1 plus e to the minus zeta pi over 1 minus zeta squared. Since it is a slightly damped system, even if it is damping as high as even 70%, still, this number is compared with 1 is very small. So we can assume this is almost equal to 1. So dynamic load factor, in this case, becomes 1 plus e to the minus zeta pi. Let's look at a few numbers here. Let's say if damping is, for instance, 10%, or 1%, I'm sorry, or damping is, say, 2%. For the case of 1% dynamic load factor, as I have the value here, would be 1.969. For 2%, dynamic factor is about 1.939. So you can easily see that even for the case of damp system, as long as you have small damping, 10 to say 40, 50% damping, this is pretty much close to dynamic load factor of 2. So for the case of impact loading, it is a fair assumption to consider a dynamic load factor of 2 in the design. If you have an impact load, you should consider a factor of 2 for the stresses compared with the static distresses, displacement compared with static displacement, or in other words, the difference between if you have a beam and you have put a load here, if you just simply have attached a load here and this goes through some displacement, which obviously would be W over K, this would be static displacement, as compared with this case that you drop this load on this beam. And of course, assuming no energy loss is attached to it and it causes displacement, okay, this would be 2 times this static displacement. That's what basically impact load means. Any questions? So what I'm going to do to demonstrate the application of the Hubble integral in at least a few cases, and also further application of that, which is in fact in demonstrating the concept of shock spectrum. That's what we are going to do. Okay. So let's see. So I'm going to start with one or two cases, and the purpose of that is that in Duhamel integral, or the general force on forces, so in the case of Duhamel integral, as we have seen, the application is obviously to demonstrate, which has been the case throughout the course, but in this case, since it is more complicated, we want to know if you have a general forcing function, how you evaluate the maximum displacement, or for instance, maximum displacement versus static displacement. Okay, that's the first application. And the second, okay, is that in the case of Duhamel integral, as we will see, in general, what is what we call a shock spectrum. We will study that. Well, the first thing to do is that, as you can see that, compared with what we have so far studied, okay, we were dealing with basically a simple differential equation. So for various cases, we solved that, which was the response of a dynamic system under, whether damped or undamped, under the action of harmonic or periodic load. In the case of Duhamel integral, you see that evaluation of the integral, or this integration, is really the essential part. In other words, in this case, we were just dealing with a simple differential equation to solve. In the case of Duhamel integral, is evaluating that integral, which is really the most, I would say, difficult or the most important part. So I'm going to spend some time going over a few example problems so you can get a good grasp of how conceptually we evaluate Duhamel integral and what that means. So let's just start with one basic example, which is, in fact, a very important example because it shows the concept very well. So let's say you have a load that is like this. A load that is what we call a ramp load or half last load or whatever you may want to call that, but it's a loading that is of a short duration of time. In fact, in Duhamel integral, one of the important applications is to really show the effect of loading of short duration. Because in harmonic loading, you can really feel that, you can relate to that, you can, you know, intuitively think of the harmonic load. But in the case of general loading, especially short duration, what happens is we don't get a good feeling. For instance, in the case of an impact load, if you know you look at it intuitively, you may assume, well, we have a constant load applied to a system, so what is the difference here between this and a static load, right? Which we saw actually there's a huge difference. If you, you know, apply a load instantaneously to the system instead of that being built as part of the system from the beginning or putting on that very slowly makes a big difference, almost doubles the effect. Same thing here. You may say, okay, this is short duration loading. So after this point, the system is not going to be subjected to any load. So why should I care about this even as a dynamic load? Because that looks like the system is not subjected to any load after this duration, so it is safe to basically design that system for with the assumption that there is no load, really serious load acting on it. These are the kind of intuitive misassumptions or wrong, you know, sort of the assumptions that are alleviated by introducing the Duhamel integral. For instance, in this case, in fact, if you look at it from the Duhamel integral point, I said that the first and foremost important part of evaluating Duhamel integral, you need to set up your forcing function. Here was easy. Before t equal to 0 was 0, after that was a constant value. Here is different. You have a load that has a linear is a linear function, so at any time tau, this would be 1 minus tau over, say, t d f 0, when the time is greater than 0 or equal to it and less than t d. And it is 0 when t is greater than td. So let's see if in a simple forcing function like this, what it does. Of course, without solving the problem, you should not use the wrong assumption that since I have no loading here, that means you don't need to worry about the effect of this load. Because knowing now about the vibration, what is happening from this point on, the loading that was acting on the system, right, at this point has resulted in an initial velocity, an initial displacement that is going to drive your system. So in other words, the effect of this load is basically from here on is just these initial conditions here, which causes a free vibration from this point on due to the action of these initial conditions. But using Duhamel integral, you can actually get a good feeling for it, why it is happening. So let's do that. So what it comes down is you need to evaluate the Duhamel integral during both of these regions, okay? So I'm going to first look at this. So these are the steps for evaluating Duhamel integral. First of all, set up the displacement function, which is this, integral from 0 to t of f of tau e to the minus zeta omega n t minus tau sine of omega d t minus tau d tau. So in this integral, tau is basically a dummy variable that you use to evaluate this integral or find the response, the answer to ut as a function of time. So let's do that, okay? If I substitute for this function, f0 is a constant, will come out. So I will get f0 over m omega d, okay? K as 1 minus tau over t d of e to the minus zeta omega n t minus tau sine omega d t minus tau d tau. So that's the integral that I will be dealing with, okay? For the time being, obviously, this is what I'm going to do. For the time being, let's make the assumption that damping is zero. So I'm going to solve the problem for a special case. So this would be 1 and omega d becomes omega n. So let's rewrite this. I will have, okay, this would be f0 over m omega n integral from 0 to t of 1 minus tau over t d sine omega n t minus tau d tau. So for this particular problem, I'm going to, although it may sound like a practice of mathematics and nothing else, but it is important that I want to go through this problem step by step. Some of those steps may even sound like trivial steps, but that's okay. I just want to show you how you evaluate this integral. So, basically, this obviously is going to come down to two parts. If I write this, factor that out, I have the integral from 0 to t of sine omega n times t minus tau d tau, okay, minus the integral from 0 to t of t tau over T D of tau sine omega n T minus tau T tau. This part, okay, in fact, is the easy one, but let's, you know, in other words, this is the easy part, because first of all, if you look at tau being a variable, so T is really a constant, right? So how do you perform that integration? That would not be difficult, right? But what I would do in order again to show that, I would substitute for sine of omega n T minus tau its trig identity, which is sine omega n T cosine omega n tau minus cosine omega n T sine omega n tau. So I would just expand it, this. So in performing this integration, as you can see, the integral of this, this would be a constant, and this would be a constant, okay? So if I do that, then I will end up with simply just these. Sine of omega, that u of t would become f zero. If I also expand this, I would get this. I would end up with something like this. If I expand this, it would be Fm omega n times, okay, integral from 0 to t of 1 minus tau over td, okay, sine omega n t cosine omega n tau d tau minus f 0 over m omega n integral from 0 to t of 1 minus tau over t d of sine omega n tau cosine omega n t d tau. T being a constant, this one and this one would come out of the integral. So this would reduce then to this, F0 over M omega N, okay? I would factor that out, times sine omega N T integral from 0 to T of cosine omega n tau d tau, okay, minus 1 over td of integral from 0 to t of tau cosine omega n tau d tau, okay. Minus cosine omega n t times integral from 0 to t of sine omega n tau d tau minus 1 over t d of integral from 0 to t of tau sine omega n tau d tau. So we can see that. That's just the beginning. You've done only 20% of the problem. Okay. So basically, though, what you see is you have four integrals to evaluate. One is this one, I call that one. This integral, two, this integral, three, and this integral, this is integral four. Integral one and three are easy, right? Integral of cosine is one over sine. Integral of sine is negative one cosine, right? So I'm going to do these step by step because integral two and integral four are the ones that are more important in terms of ease of integration. So let's look at these one by one. So I'm going to do that methodically, step by step, without skipping anything, okay? So what you have is this. The integral of that, I call that integral number one. Integral number one, which is zero to t of cosine omega n tau d tau. This would be what? One over omega n sine omega n tau evaluated from zero to t. So that would be one over omega n sine omega n t. So this is the result for integral number one. Same thing for integral number three. For integral number three, I have zero to t of sine omega n tau d tau. So this would be negative one over omega n cosine of omega n tau evaluated from zero to t. So if you evaluate that, that becomes 1 over omega n minus 1 over omega n cosine omega n t. This is in integral 3. But how about integral 2 and 4? For integral 2 and 4, you have basically t times, you have, let's say, x times cosine of x and x sine of x. To do those integrations, you have to do integration by part. So what you need to remember is the integration by part, which was u dv from a to b is uv evaluated from a to b minus the integral of v du from a to b. That's the integration by parts that we will need to use to find those. So for integral number two, okay, this is what I will do. For integral number two, I will consider u as being tau here, and therefore du is d tau. V or dv would be by cosine omega n tau d tau. Therefore v would be simply 1 over omega n sine of omega n tau. So if you substitute those into that integral, you get the integral then from 0 to t of tau cosine omega n tau d tau becomes tau over omega n sine omega n tau evaluated from 0 to t minus this part, which would be the integral from zero to t of one over omega n sine omega n tau d tau from zero to t. This part is easy, right? It would result in what? Would be just tau over, would result, evaluated from zero to t, would result in t over omega n sine omega n t. So this is this part. This one, the integral of cosine, sine would be cosine. So this would be one over omega n times one over omega n cosine of omega n, okay, tau evaluated from zero to t, okay? So that's negative of that. So if you simplify that, so for a short while, we will assume this is a course of mathematics or calculus. So this would become t over omega n, okay, sine omega n t plus 1 over omega n squared cosine omega n t minus 1. So this is integral number 2. So u of t, or no, because I have some factors. So that's integral number 2. If you do the same with 0 to t sine omega n, or tau sine omega n, tau d tau, and you consider u again as tau, same variables that I considered. U is tau, du would be d tau, dv in this case would be sine omega n tau d tau, and therefore v would be simply 1 over cosine, 1 over omega n cosine omega n tau. And you substitute that, these there, and perform the integration by parts, you will see that integral from 0 to t of tau sine omega n tau d tau would result in negative t over omega n of cosine omega n t plus 1 over omega n squared sine omega n t. So this is the solution to integral number 4. So if you substitute all of these into that equation, or the u of t, which you had, this is what's going to result. You will get, okay, u of t for the case that t is greater than 0 and less than or equal to t of d, u of d would become f 0 over m omega n sine omega n t times 1 over omega n sine omega n t minus over omega n T dd sine omega n T minus 1 over omega n squared T d cosine omega n T plus 1 over omega n squared T d. This is the first part. Minus cosine omega n T times 1 over omega n minus 1 over omega n cosine omega n T plus T over omega n T d cosine omega n T. Okay? Minus 1 over omega n T squared T d sine omega n T. So this is the response during the time that this is acting on that. You can simplify this if you do some simplification. I'm not gonna torture you. Right. Again, you can do that and factor things out. So it comes out to be, the eventual outcome would be this. 1 minus T over TD plus 1 over omega N TD sine omega n t minus cosine omega n t, which is relatively not too bad. So this is the simplified version of what we have. So this is the response when t is greater than 0 or less than or equal to td. That means while this force is acting on the system at any time t, that's the response. So in other words, if you want to find now the response at t is equal to td, you just substitute t is equal to td. Okay? So we did half the force. So we'll do the other half next time. Okay. I promise you that the other half would be easier. But let's do that because we want to eventually derive the dynamic load factor. Yes.